हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी स्टार्ट द न्यू लेसन ग्रेविटेशन। कैन यू रिकॉल? थ्री क्वेश्चंस आर गिविंग फॉर अस, सो वी रिवाइज दैट क्वेश्चंस विथ आंसर। फर्स्ट वन, व्हाट आर द इफेक्ट्स ऑफ अ फोर्स एक्टिंग ऑन एन ऑब्जेक्ट। सेकेंड, व्हाट टाइप ऑफ फोर्सेस आर यू फैमिलियर विथ। एंड थर्ड वन, वॉट डू यू नो अबाउट द ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स। सो वी रिकॉल द आंसर्स ऑफ दीज थ्री क्वेश्चंस। सो आई विल शो द आंसर। फर्स्ट वन, सो फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज वॉट आर द इफेक्ट्स ऑफ फोर्स एक्टिंग ऑन एन ऑब्जेक्ट। आंसर, द फोर्स अप्लाइड ऑन एनी ऑब्जेक्ट can cause displacement, change in shape and size of the object. It can also change the direction of motion of the object. Second question given, what type of forces are you familiar with? So in previous standard already you learned the types of forces. Now see the answer. The types of forces known to you are muscular, mechanical, gravitational, magnetic, frictional and electrostatic force. Now forces can also be categorized into balance and unbalanced force. Now that, so these types we already will learn in previous standard. Third question giving for us, what do you know about the gravitational force? The force which is applied by the earth to pull the objects towards itself is known as gravitational force. So this is the definition of gravitational force, yeah, meaning of gravitational force giving here. So these are these three questions giving for us. So we are revise or recall the answers. Now next, we have seen in previous standard that gravitational force is universal force. We know that gravitational force is a universal force and it acts not only between the two objects on the earth but also between any two objects in the universe. Let us now learn how this force was discovered. So first point given in this lesson is gravitation. As we have learned, the phenomenon means process of a gravitation was discovered by underline Sir Isaac Newton. As the story goes, the discovered the force by seeing the apple fall from a tree on the ground. He wondered why all apples falls vertically downward and not an angle to the vertical. So why do they not fly off in a horizontal direction? See the explanation giving for us here. After much thought, he came to the conclusion that the earth must be attracted the apple towards itself and this attractive force must be directed towards the center of the earth. The direction from the apple on the tree to the center of the earth is the vertical direction at the position of the apple and thus apple falls vertically downward. This is the conclusion of his question. Next, now figure 1.1 on the left shows an apple tree on the earth. 1.1, The force on an apple on the tree is towards the center of the earth. Direction is shown here. Check the direction. this is the center of the earth and apple is here. It is a vertically downward towards the center of the earth. The force on an apple on the tree is towards the center of the earth, that is along the perpendicular from the position of the apple to the surface of the earth, that is the vertical direction. The figure also shows that the gravitational force between the earth and the moon, that is shown here, this here, earth and moon, that force is also directed towards the centers between the two objects. The distance in the figure are not according to scale. That is a rough figure mentioning for us. Newton thought that if the force of the gravitation acts on apple on the tree at different heights from the surface of the earth, can it also act on object at even a greater height, much farther away from the earth, like for example the moon? So answer of this question, mark from here. Yes, the force of gravitation acts on object at even greater height. Yeah, that is a possible. And farther away from the earth, like the moon. One more question giving there. Check that. Can it act on even farther object like the other planet and the sun? Again here, answer is yes. So we are mentioning the answer here. Yes, it can act on even farther object like the other planets and the sun. That is possible. So this is a first point given here, that is the gravitation and introduction about with the help of some examples. Now next point is force and motion. We have seen that a force is necessary to change the speed as well as the direction of the motion of the object. We learn about this basic concept in previous standard also. So can you recall question giving for us? What is the question? What are the Newton's laws of motion? Yes, last year we learned the three laws related to the motion that is discovered by the scientist Newton. So we revise this. Okay, now see that. So that Newton's three laws given here. Now Newton's first law. An object continues to remain at rest or in state of uniform motion along a straight line unless an external unbalanced force acts on it. Newton's first law of motion is also called as law of inertia. Now Newton's second law. The rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the applied force, and the change of momentum occurs in the direction of force. थर्ड लॉ न्यूटन्स थर्ड लॉ ऑफ मोशन, एवरी एक्शन फोर्स हैज़ एन इक्वल एंड अपोजिट रिएक्शन फोर्स एंड विच एक्ट साइमल्टेनियसली. सो दीज आर द थ्री लॉज डिस्कवर्ड बाय द साइंटिस्ट न्यूटन. क्लियर आंसर्स गिवन हियर. क्वेश्चन गिवन ऑन पेज नंबर 1. सेम वे वन मोर क्वेश्चन देर, सो यू क्रॉस चेक द आंसर्स ऑफ दीज क्वेश्चंस. नेक्स्ट वन, नाउ सी ऑन द पेज नंबर 2. लिटिल इंफॉर्मेशन गिवन अबाउट द साइंटिस्ट. इंट्रोडक्शन टू द साइंटिस्ट. ग्रेटर साइंटिस्ट सर आइजैक न्यूटन वॉज वन ऑफ द ग्रेटेस्ट साइंटिस्ट ऑफ रिसेंट टाइम. ही वॉज बॉर्न इन इंग्लैंड. ही गेव हीज लॉज ऑफ मोशन, इक्वेशंस ऑफ मोशन एंड थियरी ऑफ ग्रेविटी इन हीज बुक प्रिंसिपिया. Before this book was written, Kepler had given 3 laws describing planetary motion. However, the reason why planets move in the way described by Kepler's laws was not known. Newton, with his theory of gravity, mathematically derived Kepler's laws. In addition to this, Newton did groundbreaking work in several areas including light, heat, sound and mathematics. He invented a new branch of mathematics, this is called calculus, and has wide-ranging applications in physics and mathematics. He was the first scientist to construct a reflecting telescope. So you remember this little information given about the Sir Isaac Newton. Now next point given in this lesson, that is circular motion and centripetal force. Try this. Tie a stone to one end of a string. Take the other end in your hand and rotate the string so that the stone moves along a circle as shown in the figure 1.2a. Here. So, are you applying any force on the stone? Some questions given for us. Think about it. In which direction is this force acting? How will you stop this force from acting? And what will be the effect on the stone? So, these several 4 questions are given here. Now check, answer is given in the next paragraph. So answer of the first sub question here. So you write down here some point before the line number 3. Before this applying word, write down there, yes, we are writing these some words, yes, I am applying a force towards applying a force on the stone. This boy applied the force on the stone. Yes, I am applying a force towards, yeah, on the stone. Answer of the second question given here. This is first question. This is second question. This is second question, third and fourth question. So this is the answer of first one. Okay, now second. Here, this is second answer. As long as we are holding the string, we are pulling the stone towards us. That is towards the center of the circle. That is the answer of that second sub question. Where is second sub question? Here. Now third sub question is, how will you stop this force from acting? So answer is, start from here. The force stops acting if we release the string. If we release the string, automatically acting force is stopped. And fourth sub question given here, what will be the effect on the stone? Answer given in the next paragraph. Clear? All that, all these answers. Now what is the answer of this fourth one? Now check that. Start the answer from here. The stone will fly off along a straight line, which is the tangent to the circle at the position of the stone when the string is released. Our answer is finish here. Okay. Now see the more explanation given about this. Because that is the direction of its velocity at that instant of time. Now in this second figure, one more figure is given. This is a B figure. You may recall that we have performed a similar activity previously, in which a 5 rupee coin kept on a rotating circular disc flies off the disc along the tangent to the disc. Thus, a force acts on any object moving along a circle and is directed towards the center of the circle. So this is called as centripetal force. So how to write down here? So we are marking the definition of centripetal force. We mark from here up to here. Make the bracket, underline. A force acts on any object moving along a circle and it is directed towards the center of the circle is called centripetal force. Centripetal means center seeking. That is, the object tries to go towards the center of the circle because of this force. You know that the moon, which is the natural satellite of the earth, goes around it in a definite orbit. The direction of the motion of the moon as well as its speed constantly changes during this motion. Do you think some force is constantly acting on the moon? So some questions given for us. So your first question, then a second question is given from here. What must be the direction of this force? Next, third one, how would its motion have been if no such force acted on it? Fourth sub question, do the other planets of the solar system revolve around the sun in a similar fashion? And fifth sub question, is a similar force acting on them? So, and what must be the direction? So these questions are given for us. Now see the answer. I will show the answer of all these 5 sub questions separately on one page. Here, all that 5 sub questions given separately. what is the first one? Do you think some force is constantly acting on the moon? So answer of this question is here given. There is a force constantly acting on moon is known as a centripetal force. Second, what is the second given? What must be the direction of this force? So answer is given here. The force is directed towards the center of the earth. Next, third one. Third sub question given. How would its motion have been if no such force acted on it? So answer of this third question given here. If there was no force acting on the moon, it would have moved along a straight line, which is the tangent to the circle. Fourth sub question given here. What is that fourth sub question? Do the other planets in the solar system revolve around the sun in a similar fashion? So answer of this fourth one is given here. Yes, other planets revolve around the sun in the similar fashion. And fifth sub question given here. Is a similar force acting on them? What must be its direction? So answer of this last one is given here. The other planets revolve around the sun in the similar fashion due to the centripetal force exerted on them by the sun. The direction of the force is towards the center of the sun. So these are the answers of that five sub-questions, that sub-questions given in the second last paragraph on page number 2 in our textbook. Check that. From the above activity, last paragraph now. From the above activity, example and question, it is clear that for the moon to go around the earth, there must be a force which is exerted on the moon, and the force must be exerted by the earth, which attracts the moon towards itself. Similarly, the sun must be attracting the planets, including the earth, towards itself. All that is happen because of gravitational force. Next point, page number 3. Kepler's laws. Now, planetary motion had been observed by astronomers since ancient time. Before Galileo, all observations of the planet's position were made with the help of naked eyes. By the 16th century, a lot of data were available about planetary position and motion. Now, Johannes Kepler, name of the scientist is underlined, Johannes Kepler studied these data. He noticed that the motion of the planet follows certain laws. He stated three laws describing planetary motion. These are called as known as Kepler's laws, which are given below. So do you know? An ellipse. What is the word? An ellipse is the curve obtained when a cone is curved by inclined plane. If we are taking the cone and we are inclined, means in cross, we are cutting this. So there is obtained this circular path. Check there. So that path is called as an ellipse. It has two focal points. See in the figure here. the sum of the distances to the two focal points from every point on the curve is a constant. F1 and F2 are the two focal points of the ellipse shown in the figure also. If point A, B and C are the three points on the ellipse, then what is the calculation given? Check that. So AF1 plus AF2 is equal to, that is distance measured from point B, that is a BF1 plus BF2 also is equal to CF1 plus CF2. So that is the obey or calculated by scientist Kepler. Now here question asked separately, state the Kepler's first law, second law and third law. So Kepler's first law, sun is given and planet, some points A, B, C, D, E and F. So Kepler's first law, the mark there, bold lines are given. The orbit of a planet is an ellipse with the sun at one of the foci. You revise again and again. These are the new concept. And remember, figure 1.4 shows the elliptical orbit of a planet revolving around the sun. The position of the sun is indicated by letter S, that is here. Now Kepler's second law, the line joining, now see there, second law, the line joining the planet and the sun sweeps equal areas in equal intervals of time. These lines are joined here with the sun and forming the area. These areas are what? These areas are equal. Take any two points on this elliptical path. So remember this second law, mark here. AB and CD are the distances A to B and C to D, even E to F also. AB and CD or even EF, all these distances are covered by the planet in equal time, that is after equal interval of time. The position of the planet starts from A, starts from C or even start from E are shown by point B up to D and up to point F. The straight line AS and CS sweeps equal area in equal interval of time, that is area ASB and CSD are equal. See in the figure, area ASB and CSD, the shaded portion is nothing but what? That is the area. These areas are what equal areas form. Mark the third law, Kepler's third law, mark there. The square of its period of revolution around the sun is directly proportional to the cube of the mean distance of the planet from the sun. Thus, if small r is the average distance of the planet from the sun and capital T is the period of revolution, then according to this third law, we are writing, what we are writing? T square means square of period of revolution is directly proportional to what? Cube of the mean distance of the planet from the sun, that is r cube. So when you write the Kepler's third law, this statement, mathematical statement, you write after writing your law. If you remove this proportionality sign, then taking one constant like this, T square is equal to K into R cube. So this R cube we are taking on left hand side, then divide. So we are obtained the step what t square upon r cube is equal to constant, and that constant indicated by letter k. So in this way, for 3 mark this question is asked, state the Kepler's first, second and third law. Last 3 lines. Kepler obtained these laws simply from the study of the position of planet obtained by regular observation. He had no explanation as to why planets obey these laws. We will see below how these laws help Newton in the formation of his theory of gravitation. Next question. Now question given for us, use your brain power. If the area ESF in figure on previous page 1.4 is equal to area ASB, so what will you infer about the ES, about the EF? So what is that EF? Already explanation given, check here. Like AB, CD and EF, what this indicate? Underline distances covered by the planet in equal time, that is after equal interval of time. So EF indicate that distance covered by the planet in equal time. That answer of that question, use your brain power. Now next, Newton's universal law of gravitation. Now question is asked here for 2 marks. State Newton's universal law of gravitation. Now all the above consideration including Kepler's laws led Newton to formulate his theory of universal gravity. According to this theory, now mark the law, start from here. Every object in the universe attract every other object with a definite force. This force is directly proportional to the product of the masses of the two objects and is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. So this is called as Newton's universal law of gravitation. You mark from here up to the end. Introduction to the scientist. Johannes Kepler. Johannes Kepler was a German astronomer and mathematician. He started working as a helper to the famous astronomer Tycho Brahe in Prague in 1600. After the sudden death of Brahe in 1601, Kepler was appointed as the royal mathematician in his place. Kepler used the observation of planetary position made by Brahe to discover the laws of planetary motion. He wrote several books. His work was later used by Newton in postulating his law of gravitation. Now figure 1.5 shows that, check here. Here two objects having a mass m1 and m2. Distance between these two objects is a d, and both the object exert the force on each other is f. So this figure shows two objects with masses m1 and m2 kept at a distance d from each other. Mathematically, the law of force of attraction between these two objects can be written as, so according to that law, that force F is directly proportional to the product of the two objects, that is m1, m2, and divided by square of the distance between them, that is a d square at the denominator. If we remove this proportionality sign, taking one constant, that is the g, so we are obtain the formula ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स एफ इज इक्वल टू कैपिटल जी इंटू एम वन एम टू अपॉन डी स्क्वायर, दैट इज इक्वेशन नंबर टू. द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस कैपिटल जी इज ये अंडरलाइन कॉन्स्टेंट ऑफ प्रोपोर्शनैलिटी कॉल्ड एज यूनिवर्सल ग्रेविटेशनल कॉन्स्टेंट. वॉट इज दैट कॉल्ड एज? यूनिवर्सल ग्रेविटेशनल कॉन्स्टेंट. नेक्स्ट, द अबव लॉ मीन्स दैट इफ द मास ऑफ वन प्लैनेट इज अ डबल द फोर्स बिटवीन द टू ऑब्जेक्ट ऑल्सो डबल. Are reading? Because the relation between these masses and force is directly proportional. Also underline, if the distance is double, the force decreases by a factor of 4, because relation between this force and distance is inversely proportional and it is a d square. Are you reading? If the two bodies are spherical, the direction of the force is always along the line joining the centers of the two bodies, and the distance between the center is taken to be d. In case when the bodies are not spherical or have irregular shape, then the direction of the force is along the line joining their centers of mass, and d is taken to be the distance between the two centers of mass. From equation number 2, what is the equation number 2? Check here, this is equation number 2. So from this equation number 2, it can be seen that the value of capital G is the gravitational force acting between the two unit masses kept at a unit distance means fixed distance, or one away from each other. Thus, underline, in SI unit, the value of capital G is equal to the gravitational force between the two masses of 1 kilogram kept 1 meter apart. So that is SI system. In SI system, that is the meaning of that value of capital G. Capital G means what? That you already underlined. That is the capital G means constant of proportionality, and specially called as universal gravitational constant. All of you getting? Now see here in box, yellow color box, use your brain power. Show that in SI unit, underline, the unit of capital G is Newton meter square per kilogram square. How to write there? See, in short, you write like this: Newton meter square per kilogram square. So raise to minus 2, that minus sign read as a per kilogram square, or that you write like this way also: Newton meter square per kilogram square. Any way you write, like this or like this, okay? So that you underline. The value of capital G was first experimentally measured by, underline, the scientist Henry Cavendish, underline, in SI units. Its value is, underline that value carefully, 6.673 into 10 raised to minus 11 Newton meter square per kilogram square. So this is a extra information given for us in that box. Next one, see in that blue box, the center of mass of an object is the point inside or outside the object at which the total mass of the object can be assumed to be concentrated. Already we learn about the atom, like a mass of an atom is concentrated in its center. Consider that point. The center of mass of a spherical object having uniform density is at its geometrical center. The center of mass of any object having a uniform density is at its centroid. Now some question again given for us. See that question. Why did Newton assume your inverse square dependence on distance in his law of gravitation? So mark the answer there. Yeah, Newton assumed inverse square dependence on distance of his law of gravitation by Kepler's third law, and after this write down that law as it is from the previous page. Kepler's third law states that, and then afterward you write down at the last you mention what is that relation given, that is T square is directly proportional to the R cube. That is the answer of this question. All are getting? Yes. Next. Now uniform circular motion or magnitude of centripetal force. Consider an object moving a circle with a constant speed. We have seen earlier that such a motion is possible only when the object is constantly acted upon by a force directed towards the center of the circle, and this force is called as the centripetal force. If m, what is the m? M is the mass of the object, v is its speed or velocity, and r is the radius of the circle, then it can be shown that the force is equal to, underline this, you make the box, that force is equal to what? m into v square upon r, because we know the formula of speed means nothing but what, that is given here, that is the distance traveled upon time taken. If a planet is revolving around the sun in a circular orbit in uniform circular motion, then the centripetal force acting on the planet towards the sun must be what? F is equal to mv square upon r, where again m means mass of the planet, v means nothing but its speed, and r means nothing but the distance from the sun. The speed of the planet can be expressed in terms of period of revolution, that is capital T, as follows. The distance traveled by the planet in one revolution is equal to perimeter of the orbit 2 pi r. R means nothing but the distance of the planet from the sun. Time taken is equal to period of revolution, that is capital T. Therefore, according to the formula of speed, v, speed indicated by the letter v, so speed or velocity v equal to distance traveled upon time taken, so is equal to distance traveled is here, that is a perimeter, that is a 2 pi r, upon time taken is a t. We are substituting the value or calculate it. Therefore, f is equal to, what is the formula? We know that f is equal to mv square upon r. So this value of v is substitute here, so m into v square, so that value we substitute here, so making the square of this bracket divided by r. After calculation we are getting 4 into m pi square r upon t square. Now multiplying and dividing by r square we get, so therefore f is equal to 4 m pi square upon r square is equal, here do the sign multiplication, make the correction here, your multiplication sign is required here. What we write? Multiplying and divide by r square, so divide by r square and multiplied by r square upon that t square, keep it as it is separately. According to Kepler's third law, t square upon r cube is nothing but the k means nothing but what? Constant.
Therefore, we are getting the formula F is equal to 4m pi square upon r square. Now, this value is of t square upon r cube. But what is the step obtained here? Exact opposite, that is r cube upon t square. So, that k we are writing at denominator. Make the bracket. But we know that 4 constant, mass is constant, pi value is constant, k is constant. These all values are constant values. Thus, Newton calculated that centripetal force, which is the force acting on the planet and is responsible for its circular motion, must be inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the planet and the sun. Newton identified this force with the force of gravity and hence postulated the inverse square law of gravitation. The gravitational force is much weaker than the force in nature. Underline very important sentence. Mark from here. The gravitational force is much weaker than other forces in nature, but it control the universe and decide the future and decide its future. This is possible because huge masses of planets, stars and the other constituents of the universe. Now use your brain power. Is there a gravitational force between two objects kept on a table or between you and your friend sitting next to you? If yes, why don't the two move towards each other? Think about this question. So I will give the answer of this question. Now check that. This is the question already asked for the 2 marks. Now see the answer. So answer is yes. There exists a gravitational force between two different objects kept on a table between me and my friend sitting beside each other. Second point, the gravitational force between any two objects is given by, we know the formula, F equal to G, M1 means mass of first object, M2 means mass of second object, and upon R square means distance between the two objects. Where, meaning of all given here, where capital F means force between any two objects in Newton, capital G means universal gravitational constant taken as 6.67 into 10 raised to minus 11 Newton meter square per kilogram square, M1 and M2 mass of the two objects in kilogram, small r means nothing but the distance between the two objects in meters. Thus, third point, any two objects attract each other, but due to their small masses, they exert a force on each other, which is too small. That force is also very small to cause any acceleration. That is very small. Hence, two different objects kept on the table, or me and my friend, don't move towards each other. That is the answer of that question. So you try to write the answer, question and answer from these pages. Come back to our next page number 6, textbook page number 6. Some solved numericals are given here. So see there, already here given. So I will show properly here. 3 numericals are there on this page number 6. See example number 1. This is example number 1. Next, your example number 2. And third one is given for us. Use your brain power. This is the third one. So all the answers. Last time we learned that in previous lesson, current electricity, how to write the answers of numerical problems. So I will show on separate paper. This is the first one. So after reading the question, you write down the given. Distance is given. Distance indicated by letter R. Mass of the first object, Mahindra. Mass of second object, that is Virat. Gravitational constant, capital G value is not changing, that is constant. What we find out? First title is given. Now to find gravitational force. Next one, write down the formula. So according to that, you are getting the marks for your steps. And then calculation your solution from by using the above formula. Substitute the value and after you try to calculate this answer in a notebook and confirm, you are getting this answer 4.002 into 10 raised to minus 7. Answer is in Newton because we find out the force. Therefore, the gravitational force between Mahendra and Virat is 4.002 into 10 raised to minus 7 Newton. Next question, given in the textbook. After reading the question, again, that is, I think, continue that question. So, first of all, you write down the given again. Force on Mahendra that we calculated in previous question. Then Mahendra's mass, 75 kilogram. To find out velocity. Now, we are using the two formulas. First formula is F equal to ma and second formula V equal to U plus AD, that is a 1 Newton's equation. By using these two formulas, we find out the answer. Now, calculation. By using the first formula, we find out the acceleration. A equal to F upon m. Substitute the value and do the proper calculation. You are getting answer. SI unit of acceleration is meter per second square, that much acceleration produced here. Now, as Mahendra is sitting on the bench, his initial velocity is zero because he is at rest position. Assuming the bench to be frictionless, from formula number 2, what is that second formula? V is equal to U plus AT. By using this formula, we find out the answer. Now, check that. Therefore, V is equal to initial velocity U0, acceleration, substituting these values and we are getting the answer. So, V means final velocity or velocity 5.34 into 10 raised to minus 9 and SI unit of velocity is meter per second. As Mahendra is moving towards Virat, the distance between them decreases, causing an increase in gravitational force. For a given mass, gravitational force is directly proportional to the acceleration. So, acceleration increases. Therefore, A is equal to formula F upon m that we calculate from above. As acceleration increases, velocity also increases. So, Mahendra's velocity after 1 second towards Virat will be underlined 5.34 into 10 raised to minus 9 meter per second and will increase with time. That is the answer of second numerical. And third one is given for us, use your brain power. So that question is given there. After reading the question right now, the answer, this question, any numerical problem asks for minimum 2 marks. So write down the given. Height is given, initial velocity u is given, acceleration a is given. To find out the time taken, t equal to question mark. Now formula, we are using the Newton's one equation here. S is equal to Newton's second equation of motion. S equal to ut plus half at square. S means displacement, u means initial velocity, t means time. A means acceleration and again t means time. By using this formula, we calculate the answer. Now calculation or solution, substitute all the values here. So what is the value of S? Actually value of S, height means nothing but vertical displacement. Height, centimeter is the CGS unit of distance that we convert into SI unit, that is a meter. So 1 divided by 100, answer is in meter. So answer is what? 0.01 meter. That value we substitute in the formula. Therefore, 0.01 is equal to 1 upon 2 because initial velocity is 0 here. So, answer is 0, only half into value of acceleration calculate multiplied by t square. So, we find out the value of t square. So, after calculation, t square is equal to, we are getting this step. After proper calculation. You do the calculation in a rough notebook and confirm you are getting the answer is this or not. So t square equal to 3.75 into 10 raised to 6, and then take the square root. You are getting the answer. Time is in second, because time is always measured in second. So in this way, with a constant acceleration, Mahendra takes 1936 seconds to move 1 centimeter towards Virat. This is a question given for us. Use your brain power and do the calculation and find out the answers. So I will show on this page. So you write in your notebook question, numerical problem with answer. Now see on page number 6. Do you know? So most of the students knowing about this. You must be knowing about the high and low tides that occur regularly in sea. The level of sea water at any given location along sea shore increases and decreases twice a day at regular intervals. High and low tides occur at different times at different places. The level of water in the sea changes because of the gravitational force exerted by the moon. Water directly under the moon gets pulled towards the moon, and the level of water there goes up, causing high tide at that place. At two places on the earth at 90 degrees from the place of high tide, the level of water is minimum and low tide occur there as shown in the figure. So you observe the figure and see the explanation. Where is occur high tide, that is showing by this blue color, and low tide is at these places. Here high tide, so as per that explanation, you observe it carefully. Next page. So you collect more information about low tide and high tide. Now next point, Earth's gravitational force. Will the velocity of a stone thrown vertically upward remains constant, or will it change with time? How will it change? Why does not the stone move up all the time, and why does it fall down after reaching a certain height? What does its maximum height depends on? So many questions are given here. So all these question with answer I will show on one paper. See, these are all these questions given on page number 7. Is right? Will the velocity of stone thrown? Check that. Yes, correct. So, answer of all that sub questions. First one, the velocity of a stone thrown vertically upwards decreases with time till it becomes zero. Second, when a stone is thrown vertically up, it is acted upon by the gravitational force of the earth, which constantly tries to pull the stone down. Due to the constant downward pull, the velocity of the stone becomes zero after reaching a certain height. Once the velocity becomes zero, the gravitational force acting on the stone causes it to start moving vertically downward. So you are familiar about this. Just explanation is given in scientific manner. Next one, third point, the maximum height of the stone can achieve depends on the initial velocity with which the stone is thrown vertically upward. So these are the answers of all that questions given here. All are getting? Check there. So these are some question with answers for recalling purpose. So we will learn with the help of answer and confirm our explanation. Now next point given on page number 7. Check there. Again, numericals are given there. So, see the explanation. Some explanation given in that two paragraphs. Here, the earth attracts every object near it towards itself because of the gravitational force. We know that the center of mass of the earth is situated at its center. So the gravitational force on any object due to earth is always directed towards the center of the earth. Because of this force, an object falls vertically downward on the earth. Similarly, when we throw a stone vertically upward, this force tries to pull it down and reduces its velocity. Due to this constant downward pull, the velocity becomes zero after a while. The pull continues to be exerted and the stone starts moving vertically downward towards the center of the earth under its influence. So, little bit explanation given of that above question in this two paragraph, as well as I will show the answer on that separate page also. Again, two solved numericals are given here. So, these two solved numericals you write in that pattern given after reading the question, given to find formula and calculation or a solution, and try to write down the answer in that pattern. Now use your brain power. According to Newton's law of gravitation, every object attracts every other object. Thus, if the earth attracts an apple towards itself, the apple also attracts the earth towards itself with the same force. Why then does the apple falls towards the earth, but earth does not move towards the apple? So answer of this question, this is use your brain power. This question given for us, we think about it. So I will show the answer on one separate paper. Is it right? Use your brain power, page number, textbook page number 7. Now see that. 2-mark question asked in the exam. The apple attracts the earth with the same force with which the earth attracts the apple. So according to Newton's third law, these two forces are equal and opposite in direction. For same magnitude of force, the acceleration produced in a body is inversely proportional to its mass. As the mass of the earth is very large compared to that of the apple, the acceleration of the earth is too small compared to the acceleration of the apple that it cannot be noticed. Hence, apple falls towards the earth while the earth does not move towards the apple. All are getting? So this is the answer given here. And last paragraph on page number 7 in our textbook. Check that. The gravitational force does due to the earth also act on the moon, because of which it revolves around the earth. Similar situation exists for the artificial satellite orbiting the earth. The moon and the artificial satellite orbit the earth. The earth attracts them towards itself, but unlike falling apple, they do not fall on the earth. Why? Underline. Because of the velocity of the moon and the satellite along their orbits. If this velocity was not there, so they would have fallen on the earth. So here we are writing one more sentence. What is that? So you write now. Along their orbits is such that it prevent them from falling on the earth. What you write after this? along their orbits is such that it prevents them from falling on the earth. Our last sentence meaning is the same. So anyway, you write the answer. So in this way, today we learn some points related to gravitation in this lesson number 1. Next point we will continue next time. Thanks.